There was an old man called Michael Finnegan. He grew whiskers on his chin again. Along came the wind and blew them in again. Poor old Michael Finnegan. Begin again. I was 5 years old when my father taught me this loopy, never-ending rhyme. And at the end of each verse, I would gleefully join in and I would say, begin again, begin again. And over the years, I've realized that this is not any ordinary nursery rhyme. It holds a deep significance in my life, which retrospectively, when I look, it's an unfolding pattern of new beginnings. I grew up in Mehsana. It's a small town, not very far from here. I was in sixth standard and I joined the school hockey team. And we were supposed to play for a tournament in Gandhinagar, so I traveled there with my team. And when I saw Gandhinagar first time, I was amazed by this wonderful city. It was a modern planned city, it's the capital of Gujarat. And all the roads met the other roads at right angles. In Mehsana, you couldn't walk 50 meters without turning left or right. I came back and I told my parents that we have to shift, we have to move. I don't want to live in Mehsana. Let's go and live somewhere close to Gandhinagar so I can study there. Now, at that time, asking my parents to make such a big move.
Yes, with all of us. So, huge round of applause for us. Speak and
I asked them to press the input button on the video in the middle of the day. So, it was like that. And
finally,
my mother, they were nice people, but they were shocked by this whole concept of leaving the city and the entire lives and moving and all of it. But even as an 11-year-old, I was very persuasive. So I said, remember dad, you taught me a nursery rhyme when I was 5 years old. There was an old man called Michael Finnegan. He went fishing with the pin again. Caught the fish and dropped it in again. Poor old Michael Finnegan. Begin again, dad, please. Begin again in a new city, in a new place. Let us begin our lives again. So we shifted to Kalur, a town which was even smaller than Mehsana. But it had one saving grace, that it had a school bus which would take me to Gandhinagar every day. And I could study in a convent school. I think this was by far one of the most notable reboots that I have done in my life. So my new life started. And today I'm going to talk about these reboots, because life is all about these reboots, you know. When you give up what you are doing and you start a new set of circumstances altogether, and you throw yourself into that. Now, a lot of times it happens because of failures or because of problems. I'm not talking about that, I'll talk about that later. But right now I'm talking about the reboots that you do willfully, out of volition, out of your own choice. I had such a choice when I was just out of college. I was a 25-year-old living in Ahmedabad, and with a very odd and confusing and a long resume. I had worked, I had done odd jobs all through my college life, you know, front office of a hotel, back office of an advertising agency, small home office of an NGO. I had even sold vegetables from a friend's shop. And alongside all these, what I had done is I had pursued my passion of theatre and television. And by the time I was 25, I was already directing a television show. Now, directing a television show is a very funny business, you know. You can easily get carried away thinking you are a very important person, because you go on the set and there are 100 people ready to obey your command. And you can say, I want 50, these 50 chairs this side and these 50 chairs this side, and nobody will ask you why. They will say, okay sir, and they will start moving their chairs. So like a lot of, you know, misled and misinformed young TV directors, I also thought I was very important. And I was doing well for myself at that age, because I had family, I had a lot of friends, I was even dating a wonderful girl, Olga. She was an actress in my play earlier, so you know how that goes. So, so one day I was trying to impress her, and I told her that, you know, Olga, I have these grand plans about my life, about my future. Ahmedabad is too small for me. I'm going to move out. I'm going to move to Mumbai. I'm going to go there and write movies and work in the film industry. And who knows, one day, you know, I will be writing a big commercial Bollywood movie, and it will become a blockbuster, it will be successful. And who knows, I might get an award. If I get an award, I have an award speech ready. From 11th standard, I've been preparing for this moment. I don't know what a lot of boys do in their bathrooms when they are adolescent, but I used to prepare for this speech. So I used to pretend for this speech, you know, and that speech, I'll give you a small example of that, a small excerpt of that speech, you know, it went like this. Ladies and gentlemen, when I was 5 years old, my father taught me a limerick. There was an old man called Michael Finnegan. And what this song has taught me is that life is full of new beginnings. You can always start afresh. And there might not be things going well for you, but then you should not despair because the movie of your life is not over yet. You can start again. Picture abhi baki hai mere dost. And I was telling all this to Ulka and she was, I don't know how impressed she was, but she said, so go to Mumbai. What are you waiting for? I said, you know, there's a little slight problem. I've done a lot of work in Ahmedabad and people owe me like almost a quarter of a million rupees in 1998-99. That was a lot of money. But I said, I don't have that money right now. I have some 1,000 odd bucks. All that money is promised, it's not come yet. So once I get that money, you know, imagine such a lot of money, we can buy a house, we can buy an apartment here. And she said, but you don't want to live here. I said, yeah, but you know, it's so much money, I cannot leave that money and go. And she said, why? But I mean, why are you stopping your life if you want to go there? I said, it's a quarter of a million rupees, like you understand. And she was like, yeah, but you don't need a quarter of a million Indian rupees to go to Mumbai. The bus ticket is only 300 bucks. She was like, you know, there are two kinds of things that we own. I mean, whatever we own can be divided in two basic categories. The first category is these material things that we own, you know, this jacket or our watch or, you know, whatever things which are close to us, which we have earned, which we have paid with our own money, we have done, whatever work, our house, our car and all those things. Not only just material things, but things that we have earned otherwise also, a reputation, intellectual property, things which we have created and we have got together. And there are other category of things which are intrinsically ours, which come to us, without really having worked hard for it. Our looks, our genetics, and to a certain extent, our mental disposition, our moral values, our upbringing, our work ethic, all these things, they kind of become, they happen to us and they become a part of us. So we don't really consciously think about these things. And It's human nature to attach value to things that we own in two ways, you know. We attach more value to things that we have earned and worked hard for. And we don't attach value to things which are intrinsically us, which are our own, right? So we attach more value to the smiles of others and not our own smile. We attach more value to the smiles of others because those have to be earned, right? So I realized that this attachment of values I had to rethink about. I was attaching a lot of value to that quarter million Indian rupees, but it was holding me back. And I had heard about this aboriginal nomadic tribe. Once a year, what they do is they burn off all their material possessions and they walk out of their whatever huts they live in. Now imagine if you knew that everything that you own is going to turn down to ashes at the end of the year. What would you do? What would you own? I had my answer. I had to leave Ahmedabad. I had to come to Bombay. And I came to Bombay in August 1999 with the only things that I really owned, which were my own, you know, my skills, my talent, my basic moral values and setup, and 700 rupees. Because 1000 bucks, 300 went for the bus ticket. I came to Bombay, but I was very lucky. I must tell that I was very lucky. The third day of my arrival in Mumbai, I had an interview with a newbie director. Now this director was making his first film. So I thought better chance of working with a new person, right? Usko bhi zarurat. So I had an interview with him. Now this gentleman we all today know as a very successful film director of Dhoom series of movies, Mr. Sanjay Gadhi. So Sanjay Gadhi sir, with my first meeting, my first interview with him, he asked me, what can you do for me? And I told him, sir, in Ahmedabad, I was an independent director. I have written and directed television shows, commercials and everything. But sir, for you, I will sweep floors also. Not a problem. So he said, will not that be beneath you, like you give up all of that training and everything and you sweep floors for me? I said, sir, when I was 5 years old, my father taught me. Sir, I am here to make a new beginning, sir. I will do whatever you ask me to do. He was kind enough to make me his chief AD and we made our first film, Tere. Now, during the making of that film, it was a small film, but I made friends. One of those friends was this composer who used to bring his guitar and he used to play for us and he made the music for our film. His name was Pritam. You all know Pritam? Okay. So Pritam used to hang out and jam with me and he used to ask me to write Tamil lyrics for him, so that he could do presentations to other music, other producers. And a lot of times I would help him with the Tamil lyrics and he would tell me that, you know, you write decent Tamil lyrics, why don't you try being a lyricist, why don't you write? And I used to always laugh at the idea. Anyway, they really released, it didn't do so well. But it opened doors for us. And Sanjay Gadhi sir came back to me with the proposal of writing his next film. And this film was my big break in Bollywood. This, my first film as a writer, was going to happen with Yash Raj Films, the biggest film studio in Mumbai. This film was Mere Aap Ki Shaadi. The next 4 years for me were like a dream. It was the most comfortable that I have been in my life, the most secure. Yash Raj was like a second home, you know. Everything was so nice and everything was so good. And during the next 4 years, I also graduated. I also, from being a chief assistant, I became the associate director, and I was handling a lot of important work for YRF. And I also started owning a lot of things again. I had a car, second hand, but I had it. I had a house, it was on loan, but I had it. And I had a very important job. But we made Dhoom, and Dhoom became a big hit. I was on the verge of, you know, the next big thing, whatever was going to happen, and that was going to be the sequel of Dhoom. And we were going to make Dhoom 2, but I was having a strange feeling of discomfort, because I thought that I'll go back to the same desk, I will be taking the same decisions like I do every day, the same thought process, and it was somewhere discomforting me to live the same life again. And I thought that I might not be happy doing it. So probably I needed to rethink and redo some stuff. And I told my predicament to Ulka. You remember Ulka? The girl who was my girlfriend, who pushed me to come to Mumbai. She was my wife now. We were married. So I told her that, you know, I'm not happy about it. So she said, quit the job. I said, are you mad? I have the best job in the world. How can I quit it? She said, yeah, but you'll be happier doing other things. You know what? You could write films outside. And maybe one of the films that you write, it will become a big hit. And it will be a blockbuster. And maybe you'll get an award. How cool will that be? And you anyways have your award speech ready. I said, okay. So with these starry dreams in my eyes, I quit Yash Raj Films. And immediately afterwards, I was plummeted into a vortex of uncertainty, fear, and an abyss of despair, because there was no money, you know. Some days I did not even have money to put in petrol in my car. And it was one of those days in despair when Pritam, my guitar friend, composer friend, he called me up and he said that one of the dummy lyrics that I had written for him, they were loved by our director who was making his first film. His name was Vivek Agnihotri. He was making Chocolate. And he said, come and write this song. We will pay you 15,000 rupees. I said, 15,000? That was like a full month's salary. I wrote that song. And this, ladies and gentlemen, was 2005. In the last 10-12 years, I have written over 110 songs in different Hindi movies, and a lot of them have been successful. Now, if I hadn't left the Yash Raj, I would have never become a lyricist. Because I would have never had that fear of doing something new. And I did not even know that I could do that. Only Pritam pushed me, and I did it because there was no other option. I had to get the money somehow. So strange things happen when you push yourself, you know. This, when you go into this kind of a setup, when you give up things, there is one thing that you can never give up, and that is your innate talent. That is your innate, wisdom, or the skill set that you have acquired. So that can never go away. Anyway, I started writing songs and everything, and life was good, you know. In 2005, my first son was born, Aravind, and I was very happy. And immediately afterwards, I got this big movie to write, which, you know, certain projects in your life, they are like your midline between your before and after. So that was Om Shanti Om. Like, my life before Om Shanti Om and after Om Shanti Om was going to be completely different. And this was a big project, because the hero in this film and the producer of this film was no less than the king of Bollywood, Mr. Shah Rukh Khan. So I was very happy doing it. But before I actually started writing the film, Farah ma'am, she came to me and she said that I want you to write this one scene, you know. And it was a very important scene in the film, where Om Prakash Makhija, the hero of the film, he is a struggling junior artist, he's an extra, and he's holding a beer bottle and is pretending to give an award speech. I said, I got it. I had my award speech ready, you know. And that is one of the most notable things that I have written, you know, picture of Bhatia Mirisos. So Om Shanti Om released in 2007. I feel good to say that I became kind of a minor celebrity. I became a star. And producers were sending champagne bottles and cakes to my house to sign me on for their next film. So I also became a little, as natural, as human as I can be, I also became a little arrogant, and I also became a little, too full of myself. And That was the time when I said that no, I don't want to write too many movies, I want to direct. In 2008, I got that opportunity, 2008-2009. There was this big producer and she offered me to produce a film for her, and she offered me to direct a film for her which she would produce. It had a wonderful cast. And for the next 2 years, I shot that movie over 70 days, over 50 locations in Turkey, in Goa, in Rajasthan, in Mumbai. It was like a dream. I had a great cast and everything was going well. And again, the same thing on the set as a director, 100 chairs here, 50 chairs there. Everybody was following my instructions. I'm very happy. It was too good to be true. And it was. Because what happened was, at the end of 2 years, I realized that I was staring in the face of a nightmare. My producer did not get along with me. And she had a different vision of the movie, I had a different vision of the movie. And we had creative differences. And when you have a creative differences with your producer and you are the creative person, the only natural thing that happens is that you are shown the door. So I was shown the door and the film was taken away from me. Now she would get the movie rewritten and she would direct it and she would complete it. The media had a field day, there were reports every day coming, Mayur Puri doesn't know what he's doing and this and that. And I was facing this immense predicament where I knew that whatever I had earned, whatever I had done in the last 10 years is actually going down the drain. I cannot salvage the situation because the last 2 years I was working on this film. So I had no job, I had no other scripts happening, I had no songs happening, and Olga was pregnant. We were expecting our second child. I was in complete despair. I was supposed to be happy, but every day I was so scared, I was terrified. I did not even know whether I had it in me anymore, whether I could write again. I was so worried. And I still remember those days. It was August 2010 when Aravir, my firstborn, he turned 5 years old. And I was trying to cheer him up on his birthday and I told him, listen Abu, when I was your age, when I was 5 years old, my father taught me a song. There was an old man called Michael Finnegan. He grew fat and then grew thin again. Then he died and had to begin again. Poor old Michael Finnegan. And Abu said, begin again! Begin again, begin again! And I started again in a different voice. You know, there was an old man called Michael Finnegan. He grew fat and then grew thin again. Begin again! On jumping and dancing and playing the song, maybe I realized this was the time to make the biggest beginning again of my life. I would have to press that reboot button once more, very firmly. What happened in these last couple of years is that Ulka had done a lot of research in storytelling and she had curated tons of stories. So I thought maybe it is time for me to help somebody else to reboot. So all the money that I had left from my Bollywood work, I took it and I pooled it and I put it into this organization called Story Circus, which I started with Ulka, and it had nothing to do with Bollywood. Over the weekends, Ulka and I, we would gather little children and we would tell them stories. It's very difficult to hold the attention of a 3-year-old or a 6-year-old, you know. It's very, very different kind of storytelling. For me, it was a huge readjustment of how I used to think and do things because I was not writing a big Bollywood movie. There was no scale. I had to scale down my thinking. You know, everything is here. You can only use your hands. You can only use your voice. Nothing else. That taught me a lot to hold attention of little kids. And when I came back to writing Bollywood movies, I applied the same simple principles and effectiveness of storytelling. And I once again started writing movies. I wrote Happy New Year, once again starring Shah Rukh Sir. I wrote ABCD, I wrote ABCD 2. I wrote more songs. At this time, I was much more successful than earlier. Life was again back to normal. Last year, I had again a very big shift in thinking. You know, Disney Studios, they came to me with the proposal of writing the Hindi version of The Jungle Book. Now, The Jungle Book, everybody knows it's a great story. And I wanted to do it, but I always thought that I was a writer, I was a creative writer, and I was not a translator. It was not my craft. Whether I could do it or not, I don't know. But one thing Story Circus had taught me, and that thing was that you can take stories, existing stories, and you can own them. You can tell them in your way, and you can make it more relatable to people, your way. And I started doing that, and I just asked one favor from Disney people, and they were very kind enough to let me do that. And I said that, let me do it in my own way, you know. And I started doing that, and I'll give you a small example. Like in the English version, Bagheera tells Mowgli that your tricks are not welcome here. Now the straight translation of that would be that tumhari tarkeeb yahan nahi chalegi. The tricks is tarkeeb in Hindi. But that word won't do because it had a little negative connotation. Right? I wanted Mowgli to be the hero and I wanted him to be an innovator and an engineer sort of boy with that kind of a mind. We Indians are innovators, right? So I used the word jugaad instead of tarkeeb. So I said tumhari jugaad yahan nahi chalegi. Now we all understand what jugaad is, right? We are all Indians. So these kind of things when I did, in doing that process somehow, I owned that project. It became new. It was the most successful animation movie which was translated or redubbed in a Hindi film scenario. And it received a lot of success. What happens is, when you look at things again, when you press a reboot button, when you just give up things that you thought were very important, something happens to your brain. Amazing things happen. You get rewired. You're pushed into a corner and it taps into the hidden potential which is inside you. Now think of this as if you're playing a video game and you enter into the beast mode of your avatar. Right? So this is the beast mode of working. If you want to enter the beast mode, you have to give up things. You have to, people say that never give up. I say give up. Doesn't matter. You must give up things to discover new things. Now, it's of late I teach screenwriting over weekends to students, and I often tell them that these are the two magic words that you got to live by: begin again. Because if you begin again, then you don't know where you will go. And a lot of times what happens is that we are not actually living our own life. We are living these different roles. We are a father, a brother, a neighbor, a boss. And what is left of us is just that switching between these roles the moment. That when we are switching from one role to the other, that little moment is us. That's not a great way of living. People say that they have life-changing experiences because they went to Ladakh, they went to see the northern lights in Scandinavia, or they took a trip in the Dead Sea. Well, there is some truth to it and it sells a lot of travel brochures for sure, but that's a temporary solution. You know, if you are living a life in a cubicle and thinking the same way every day, and then you go to Ladakh for 5 days and you come back and you sit in the same cubicle and start thinking the same way again, I've got news for you, my friend. You haven't pressed that button, right? So, if you have felt that you are on the verge of trying something new and you have felt there is something that is stopping you from doing it, let me quickly tell you about the time in my life when I was a 5-year-old. My father taught me this song which goes like this. Come on, sing with me. There was an old man called Michael Finnegan. He grew whiskers on his chin again. Long came the wind and blew them in again. Poor old Michael Finnegan. Begin again. Begin again. Because why live one life when you can live many lives in this one? Thank you.